Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled Designing Synchronous Counters Using D Flip-Flops. So we went over in our previous lecture how to design a synchronous counter that could count in whatever sequence we wanted to using JK flip-flops. Okay, the little secret is I actually kind of showed you guys the hard way first. And in comparison, this D flip-flop method is going to be substantially easier. We're even going to use the same two examples here to illustrate you can use different technology to design a finite state machine. This first example was, again, is our 2-bit gray code up counter. There is no external inputs. It's just a MOR machine. Its next state is dependent upon its present state only. So we've got our present input. We can determine our next state. And what I've drawn here on the bottom is D flip-flops, okay? There's only one input. Okay, whereas a JK flip-flop has two inputs and four different modes, what's D flip-flop do? Well, the value Q, it's basically sampling D at those positive clock edges. So what we have to do is just make D, the input D, equivalent to what we want to that next stage to be. And you can really simplify this is, what is that next state input there? Well, that's D. We want our next state, our ideal next state. Say, for example, right here, we're looking in this column, Q1. What do we want the input for D1 to be? Well, we want it to be this one right here. At that next positive clock edge, we want it to be Q1. At the next positive edge for Q0, we want D0 to be that. So it's very simple. All we're going to do is make our K maps for D1 and D0. Basically, Q1 is D1. That's the input for stage Q1. What is the input for stage Q0? Well, it's D0. We want those values. So what we're going to do is we're going to take D1, go ahead, populate our K-maps, take D0, populate our K-maps, and you should come up with something like this. Okay, so we've populated the K-maps for each stage's inputs. And now what I can do is just go ahead and take the minimum SOP expressions for each stage's inputs. Okay, I've determined the minimum SOP expression for each stage inputs. What I've resulted with is D1 is Q0, D0 is not Q1. We'll go ahead and next step, we're going to go ahead and implement the design. And then what we're going to do, we're going to test it. Okay, so look at our implementation there. D0 is being fed not Q1, and D1 is being fed Q0. So let's go ahead and try a timing diagram analysis of this. And what we've got is right here. I've redrawn the implemented circuit here. So at the first, let's go ahead and assume that we are in state 0, 0. And again, we are a 2-bit gray code up counter. Let me just redraw the state diagram real quick just to make sure that we are implementing exactly what we want to. And in a perfect world, we are in state 0, 0. We will transition to 0, 1, then from there to 1, 1, from there to 1, 0, and back to 0, 0. So what I've drawn is the output stages Q1 and Q0, but additionally, I've drawn not Q1 so we can do our timing diagram analysis. First positive edge comes along. What is the state of D0? Well, it's not Q1, which is currently a 1. At that positive edge, Q0 suddenly becomes 1. And again, there's a slight delay right there. What is the input for stage Q1? Well, it's Q0. Q0 at that positive edge, if we remember right, was a 0. So what does Q1 do? It stays a 0. And not Q1 is obviously staying 1. So what we did, we went from 0, 0 up to 0, 1, just like we expected in our timing diagram. So let's go ahead and see if we move to stage 1, 1 now. Next positive edge comes along, samples Q0 right there, samples not Q1 right there. D0's input is not Q1, so it's going to stay a 1. And now, what is the input for stage Q1? Well, it's D1, which is Q0. It's a 1, so what happens here is Q1 is going to go up to 1. We've made that transition to, as we'd expect, 1, 1. What does not Q1 do? It goes back down to 0. Go ahead and do the next input. Obviously, we should hope that we're going to go to 1, 0. And at that positive edge, the D0 input is a 0. So that goes to 0. And then the D1 input at that positive edge is a 1, so it's going to stay a 1. We've made that transition to 1, 0 as we'd expect for a gray code counter. Next positive edge comes along. The D1 input is a 0. The D0 input is a 0. Where have we gone? We've gone to 0, 0, as we'd expect for our 2-bit gray code up counter. So if you do these timing diagrams over, you should see that entire sequence 11, all the way down to 10, and we're starting back again at 00. So there's an alternative method to doing this, and it's substantially easier than using the JK flip-flops. So let's go ahead and use what we've done here using D flip-flops, and let's do that same example that we did for designing synchronous counters using JK flip-flops. So our next example of designing synchronous counters using D flip-flops is a finite state machine that is actually a Mealy machine, where its next state is dependent not only on its present state, but some external input. And if you're looking at this state machine diagram, you'll recognize this is the same one I did in the analysis of synchronous counters and the same one I did in designing synchronous counters using JK flip-flops. What I'm trying to do is show you that you could potentially implement this same counter using a different technology, in this particular case, a D flip-flop. And using D flip-flops to design a synchronous counter like this is substantially easier than JK flip-flops, because again, there's only one input. And what is the input D for each particular stage? What it should be? It should be the next state. So all we're going to do is just take that next state and make that our D input. What we did was we read our state machine diagram, determine our present state and the external input, determine the next state. What is the D inputs? Well, it is the next state. What we can do is take those D inputs and put those into individual K maps. So basically D1 is going into the D1 K map, D0 is going into the D0 K map. Go ahead and evaluate those individual expressions. What I came up with for the D1 expression is X and Q1 and not Q0, or not X and Q0, or not X and not Q1, or not Q1 and Q0. The D0 expression, we've got a big old group of four there. It's not Q0, not X and not Q1, or X and Q. So now what I can do is go ahead and implement this design and test it. And using a timing diagram is going to be a little bit complicated for this. So we're actually going to go ahead and kind of use a tabular analysis of this to go ahead and see, okay, here are our D inputs. Here is a synchronous counter with the following D inputs. And what I've done is I've drawn our SOP expressions for D1 and D0. And notice here too, D1 is matching this right here. D0 is matching this. So there's a little bit of a flip-flop there. Just got to, again, stay organized. And based on those input states, here are our inputs right here. Evaluate each one of those individual intermediate expressions for D1. Based off those present inputs there, evaluate the intermediate stages for D0. Based upon those intermediate stages, evaluate D1 and D0. What's the next state? Well, it is D1. D0. So let's go ahead and, at least for the D1 column, go ahead and evaluate those intermediate expressions for D1, and you should look something like this. So those are the intermediate product terms for D1. Let's go ahead and figure out what the OR of all those product terms are. It should look like something like this. Now go ahead and do the same thing for D0's intermediate expressions, determine those values. So based off those intermediate product terms, evaluate D0. It should look something like this. And there we have it. What is the next state Q1, Q0, the next time that positive edge comes along? Well, it's D inputs, i.e. D1 and D0. So we can go ahead and just translate D1 and D0 over to that next Q1, Q0 column. It should look something like this. And now go ahead and see, does that present state of 00 in mode 0, does it go, where does it go? It goes to 11. So when X is 0, it goes that way. We are in present state 01, mode 0. Where do we go to? Also to 11 when X is 0. Basically, what I'm doing is reconstructing this state diagram based on an analysis of what we came up with from the design, and see, does it in fact institute the state machine diagram which we wish to? And you'll find, as you go through these present states, next states for each mode, because again, this is mode X equals 0 and mode 1, it does in fact implement the desired finite state machine. Again, designing synchronous counters, you can use JK flip-flops or D flip-flops. D flip-flops are substantially easier because, again, there's only one input there. We've designed a synchronous counter using a JK flip-flop. We've designed a synchronous counter using D flip-flops. Let's go ahead and see how counters work in VHDL. Before we move on to the next lecture, though, remember the two exercises that I gave you at the end of designing synchronous counters using JK flip-flops, the 2-bit binary / gray up counter, and then the 3-bit even odd counter. You might want to take a look at those two suggested designs to go ahead and see if you can implement those designs using D flip-flops.